Welcome to the video lecture series on sociology. Today we'll be talking about two concepts, social control and deviance, from the chapter Terms, Concepts and Their Use in Sociology from the class 11 textbook. When we talk about social control and when we talk about deviance, both these concepts are used very often in sociology. Now, what exactly is social control? Social control refers to the various means used by society to bring its unruly members back into line. And it's a means by which society gets its members to conform to standard values, to conform to the accepted behavior in society. Now, when we talk about social control, there are two types of social control. One is formal control and another one is the informal social control. When we talk about formal social control, it's codified, systematic, formal mechanism, and they are the written rules, for example, law. And when we talk about informal social control, these are personal, unofficial, and uncodified. Another thing is, when we talk about social control, there are internal social control and there are external social control. So let's discuss about what internal social control are and what external social controls are. Internal social control is a control that lies within the individual, and this is developed during socialization. Throughout our life, I mean, we come across certain situations wherein those situations teach us what to do and what not to do. And like throughout our life, we learn all these things. And this is what internal social control is. And we act according to the social norms because we fear punishment. And if we take an example, the norm against stealing has become a part of most of us. And we have internalized this. And there are many other such things. Say, for example, not to lie and not to speak loudly when you are in a library or a hospital. These are all internal social control. And we learn these internal social control through the process of socialization. Now, external social control has to be based on social sanctions. And what these sanctions are, these are rewards and punishments designed to encourage desired behavior. There could be positive sanctions and there could be negative sanctions. Say, for example, if that sanction is given by, say, for example, our friends or our family members, then it becomes an informal sanction. But if these sanctions are given by, for example, school authority, then it becomes a formal sanction. So this is about social control, and this is about, you know, the internal social control and the external social control. Now, let's talk about who exercise social control in a society. There are number of systems, there are number of organizations which exercise social control in any society. And in any society, I mean, this phenomena is there. Now, if you look at, you know, there are certain systems which are there in a society and which regulates, you know, the behavior of, you know, the member of society. For example, family, religion, education, media, legal system, political system, and peer group. And they all exercise social control in one way or the other. In our previous discussions, we have understood that in sociology, we have different perspectives and debates over the different concepts. Now, when we talked about the functionalist sociologist, they see and they understood society as essentially harmonious. And when we discussed about conflict theorists, they said that the society is unequal, unjust, and exploitative. Now, let's apply both these perspectives to the social control. Now, when we look at social control from the functionalist perspective, it says that, you know, the social control is use of force to regulate the behavior of the individual or groups. And social control refers to enforcing values and patterns for maintaining order in the society. And it is directed to restrain the deviant behavior of individual or groups on the one hand, and to mitigate tensions and conflicts among individuals and groups to maintain social cohesion. So if you look at the social control from the functionalist perspective, it is seen as necessary to stability in society. And this is what it says, that, you know, when we talk about social control, it is necessary because it brings stability in society. If we look at social control from conflict theory perspective, we look at social control as a mechanism to impose the social control of dominant social classes on the rest of the society. And law would be seen as writ of the powerful and their interest in society. Now, it is very clear to you what is the difference between, you know, the social control when we look at it from the functionalist perspective. It says that it's important to have social control. It is important to, you know, enforce certain things because we want to have stability in society and because we want to have, you know, the cohesion in the society. But the conflict theory says that the social control is from the dominant class and for the other classes. So it actually creates the unrest in the society, and this is the main difference between, you know, the functionalist perspective and the conflict theory perspective. So the social control now refers to the social processes, techniques and strategies by which the behavior of individual or groups are regulated. It refers to both to the use of force to regulate the behavior of the individual and groups, and also refers to enforcing of values and patterns for maintaining order in society. Now we have understood the concept of social control, and we know that the social control is to restrain divines. Now what exactly do we mean by divines? Divines is like deviating from any normal behavior, deviating from any normal situation. This is what we call divines. And when we talk about such people, they are considered as black sheep of society, living on the fringes and doing what they please with no regard for normalcy. And, you know, the society also acts against them. But in functionalist theory, every part of society plays an important role to maintain stability. Deviants are no exception. As a part of society, liked or not liked, they have a positive role to play. And it might be surprising for you when we say that, you know, what positive role can divines play in a society? So let's have a look at, you know, some of the theorists' work and what do they say about, you know, the divine behavior, and look at, you know, this behavior and this concept from the functionalist perspective. According to Louis Kozer, divines brings the community together by arousing the community to the consequences of infringements of rule. The divine acts as a lesson to others, showing what can possibly come from defying the norms. So this is how it actually benefits the society. Though the divines are doing something which is not normal, but they are also setting example to the entire society that this could be the consequences of such behavior. According to Emily Durkheim, crime brings together upright consciences and concentrates them. Durkheim, along with George Herbert, also states that the attitude of hostility towards the lawbreaker has the unique advantage of uniting all members of the community. Divines alerts the society to the importance of certain norms and defines a group morals. Now you can take an example. Say for example, someone is sitting in a library, a group of students, they are sitting in a library and they are studying. And there is one person who is speaking very loudly in the library. So what happens? Through that particular procedure, the people who are sitting in the library, who are studying, they get together against that person. So this is what, you know, the this particular thing does. And this is how we can say that, you know, the divines can also play a positive role in the society, and this is the functionalist perspective. And now let us look at divines from the conflict theory perspective. Those at top create laws to maintain social inequality. Laws are often instruments of oppression. The powerful are more able to bypass the court system. And you might have seen, you know, how many of the well-off are answerable to law. Now, this is the difference between the functionalist theory and the conflict theory when we talk about divines. When we talk about, you know, the functionalist theory, the divines also plays a positive role. It is an important part to bring about the stability in the society. But in conflict theory, it creates inequality, it is unjust, and it creates unrest in the society. Now, let's have a look at another theory. This is called structural strain theory. And this theory combines both functionalist theory and the conflict theory. We have just discussed, you know, what functionalist theory is and what conflict theory is from the perspective of, you know, the divines. Now, let us look at this theory. And this theory says that some divines is inevitable in society. Yet he also believes that an individual's position in the social structure will affect his experience of deviance and conformity. So when he says that some deviance is inevitable in society, he's talking about that functionalist thing, which says that, you know, each and every part of a society functions in coordination with each other to bring out stability in a society. And when he talks about the second thing, he says that, you know, the individual positions in the social structure will affect the experience of deviance, which means that there are certain behavior in a one particular class, it could be considered as a normal behavior. Maybe in an upper class, it could be called as a normal behavior, but the same behavior in the middle class or in the lower middle class could be considered as a deviant behavior. And he also set out and explained the four different categories of, you know, people who adopt, you know, deviant behaviors, and he labeled them as innovators, ritualists, retreatists, and rebels. Now, before we come on to all these people and the characteristics of all these deviant behaviors, first thing is that, you know, other than these, there are certain people who are known as conformists. Now, the conformists are the people who are totally different from all these four people, because conformists are the people who believe in the goals which are set out by the society, and they also believe very strongly in the ways and the means in which those goals are achieved. And now let's try to understand the characteristics of the other four behaviors and the deviant behaviors. First, let us take innovators. Who are innovators? They are the people who agree with the goal society set, but they does not agree with the society approved way to attain them. They work towards those goals by alternate methods. So they believe in the goals, but, you know, the means to achieve that goal, I mean, they have their own way of reaching to those particular goals. Now, ritualists have given up the hope to meet the goals society sets, but they keep on acting as if they are trying to. So they keep on working, you know, in any situation, and they just try to portray that they want to achieve the goals which are set out by the society. Now, retreatists, they are the people, they do not agree with either the society goals or the means in which they try to attain them, and they does not conform to society and norms at all. And the last category is of rebels, who do not agree with either the society goals or the means in which they try to attain them. Instead, they work towards different goals by different means. Now, I hope you have understood the difference between the retreatist and the rebels. Retreatist, I mean, they do not conform with those, you know, the goals which are set out by the society and also the means. But the rebels are different in a way that they also do not believe in those goals and the means, but they actually work out, you know, the different means, they work out and they decide for the different goals in the society. So this is how they are different from the retreatist. Now, this actually leads us to one very important activity which you people, which you students can do in classroom. Now, classroom, in any classroom, we have a group of, you know, more than 30 or 35 students, and it is very important and it is very obvious that when we talk about a group of 30 students or 40 students, we would see, you know, many of a deviant behavior. So can you as a student categorize your classmates into these categories? Try to do this in your classroom. It will be a very interesting exercise for you, and try to share your observations with us. We have created a Google group for you, and I think by now you know that the address of that Google group, and you are you know, posting your comments and observations there. So this is all for now. Just to have a recap, today we discussed about social control, and we discussed about the deviance and the, you know, the deviant behavior in a society. So this is what we have discussed till now, and that's all for the day. Thank you.